Hello and welcome to a super special episode of Pop Wild. Today we are talking about a topic that is near and dear to my heart, bees. And we have a wonderful guest with us, Sylvana Ross, who is a beekeeper and science educator with the Queen City Pollinator Project. Hello, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
I know that humans have a long history with bees and that they're important to us, but could you tell us how bees are important to humans?
Bees are immensely important to human beings. And I think when we think of bees, a lot of time we think of honeybees. And yes, they're extremely important for us because they help pollinate our crops that feed the whole entire world population. So not only honeybees really important, but think about our native bees. They're also extremely important to our health. And so think of our ecosystem, just where we live in general, the air that we breathe. Our native bees help pollinate those flowers and those plants that help contribute to our healthy ecosystem. And then they're important to our human history. So honeybees aren't native to the United States. They were actually brought over by European settlers in the 1600s because they knew the importance of honeybee pollination for our crops. But our native bees have been here for eons, for millions of years, kind of going and co-evolving with the flowers that have also been in our lands for millions of years.
So you're using this word native.
Yes.
We've talked about it a little bit on the show before, but could you explain to our viewers what we mean when we say native bee?
Yeah, so when I say native bee, I'm speaking of species that have been in this area, have been evolving in this ecosystem, and that have kind of depended on this ecosystem, whether it's like millions of years or tens of thousands of years, but that species has evolved here. When we say something like invasive or naturalized, we're talking about species that have been brought from other countries, from other ecosystems, that are actually doing well in this ecosystem, and that when they are naturalized, we are dependent on them. So like honeybees are naturalized, they can survive in the ecosystem without human interaction, but they're not from here. And so they're not used to our ecosystem, not used to our weather. But our native bees that are native to Ohio are used to our winters. They're used to our hot summers. So they are able to navigate our ecosystem a lot better.
Obviously, there's multiple species of bees because we're talking about honeybee species, the species that is honeybees, and also native species. But how many species of bees are there?
Oh, yeah, it's insane. Okay, so just in Ohio, we have about 400 native bee species. And then think about the entire United States, and we have about 4,000 native bee species. But if you think about the entire planet, there are about 20,000 different species of bees in the entire world. And so not only are they important for here, but they're important for our ecosystems across the globe.
I've seen so many pictures of different kinds of bees, like super teeny tiny bees, and then, you know, the big jumbo bumblebees. There's so much beauty in the bee diversity as well.
Oh yeah. Different colors, shapes, sizes. We have bees that pollinate different types of flowers, some that are specialists, so they visit very specific species or genera of flowers, and some that are generalists, so they'll visit a bunch of different types of flowers.
So one thing we haven't talked about yet is social bees versus solitary bees. And I like to think of them as like bee extroverts and bee introverts. But what exactly do we mean by a social bee versus a solitary bee?
Our social bees are things like our honeybees and our bumblebees. And so they live in something called a colony. And in a colony, they're usually structured with a queen or one individual that lays eggs. And then they have their worker bees, which are the ones that do all of the work. So they're the ones cleaning, taking care of the queen, feeding and cleaning the young, and then they're also foraging. So they're going out and collecting pollen and nectar and bringing it back to their hive. Now, a lot of our bees that we think of when we think of bees are our social ones, but a majority of our native bees are solitary, which means it's one female doing all of the work. So she goes out to a flower, she collects pollen and nectar, she brings it back to a nest that she's built, whether it's in a hollow stem or a hole in your porch, or whether it's underground where she makes some tunnels. And she'll lay an egg, and then she'll provision some pollen and nectar for that egg and close off that chamber. And she might lay a couple dozen to a couple hundred, depending on the species. But solitary bees, yeah, they're doing it all by themselves.
Do you have a favorite bee?
Oh, a favorite bee? Yes. I mean, all the bees. Don't tell any bee, but all the bees are my favorite bees. But some of my favorite are called Agapostomum, and they're shiny green sweat bees. And we have them here in Ohio, and they're pretty abundant, and they're long-lasting, so they're usually pollinating throughout the growing season. But you can see them on a variety of flowers. They're generalists, and they're tiny and shiny, like iridescent green, and they're beautiful. Like, I think they're just like the gems of the bee world. Oh my gosh, I should have put some ketchup on the sauce.
dog. There's so many.
What can people do at home or in their lives to support bees?
Yes, that's like my favorite question, because sometimes we think of you need a big garden or access to a yard or the fact that you own land in order to have a beautiful large pollinator garden. And that's one way we can contribute, right? Planting a pollinator garden that's full of native plants that not only just bloom for 2 weeks out of the year, but having flowers that bloom in the early spring, some that bloom in the summer, and then some that also bloom in the fall. We do have a lot of native bees that are only active during the fall, and so they need that food resource, even in like October and September. Also, not spraying your yard with pesticides and insecticides. That's a big reason why a lot of our native bees, we're seeing population declines. We're not exactly sure how it's affecting them, but we know when we spray for mosquitoes or we spray to kill our weeds, we're also harming the pollinators that feed off of those plants. And speaking of weeds, keep the weeds in your lawn. The dandelions and the clovers and the plantain are some of the most important resources for our urban pollinators, and that's usually the only food that they have access to. So leaving those plants until they bloom and are pollinated is extremely important for making sure that our pollinators have food. And then some of my favorite things to get excited about nature and excited about the things in your ecosystem. And so I always say get curious, because I live in a little apartment, so I can't plant a big pollinator garden. But just like getting curious and learning about what's in your ecosystem and what's supposed to be in your ecosystem and maybe what's not there is a really important step to be able to understand what we need to do to be able to attract more pollinators and to save a lot of species.
Awesome. So there's a lot we
can
do,
actually. There's a lot. So many things.
Well, thank you so much for being here today.
Yes.
And thank you all for watching. And hopefully you can take some of these tips that Sylvana gave us and think about how we humans can write the story with bees going forward.